process development team for advanced transistors based on novel epitaxial transition and vitalization for silicon, silicon germanium channel, and gate all around transistors for Intel 20A, 18A, and 14A CMOS logic technology nodes. Anand received 2008 Semi North American Award for process integration of string enhanced mobility technique for CMOS transistors. He's co-authored more than 50 technical publications and holds nearly 300 US patents. Anand received his PhD from the University of Southern California in material science and engineering. Now please join me to welcome Anand.
Ways. One being what is called
the Bernard scaling, and this is the classical scaling wherein you essentially scale these features both in the assembly by direction by 30%, and the other parts are like scaling that you get the units density because of the area is increased by half. You reduce the VCC and get the needed immersion shock. You reduce the key off or the gate off thickness. And this worked really well from the early 70s till into the late 90s. And but then that really ran out of steam. The judges could not really scale continually. And so we had to really come up with other ways. And that really wanted to the dimensions relating to the norm. Non-conventional diamond scaling. And the very first one was really about the strain silicon. I had the distinct privilege of actually working on that. The invention of uniaxial strain PMOS transistors, wherein what you are seeing is the transistors that you research the source strain region, and then your epitaxially grow boron, rock silicon, germanium. And as long as the epitaxial and free of defects, then because of the larger lattice content of silicon germanium, it would impart the hydrostatic stress and get compressive channel, and this in turn will give you the increased channel mobility and therefore the bright currents. This was very unique and this really helped address the use of scaling, and it continued at least few more generations on the planar transistors. We did something very similar also on the NMOS, where we introduced the structure dislocation that erased source strain, and that also helped really give the needed strain. The next discussion point was really, again, material dimension with the high-k metal gate, and this was because the silicon oxide was really running out of steam, it could no longer decrease the oxide thickness, and therefore we had to really come out with the high-k metal gate, which was successfully introduced in our 22 nanometer node. And next really came our the what I call the 3D era, and this started with the 22 nanometer node in the triplet or the triplet transistors, and showed we have some cross sections here, the very early transistors that we had on the 22 nanometer, and this has really been the workhorse for the triplet even today, and we've been able to continually optimize or change the channel material to be able to continue the scaling. So, what Moore predicted back in 65 was that the components would increase by 2x every 2 years, and it was really an economic observation. He really did tell us really how it would be done, and he just made that observation, and I thought it would, and that what essentially currently drives the steel and driving force for the technological and social change and productivity and economic growth. And it's really all about the economics, and that is shown in here. If you look at the number of components per die, that you can see that as a function of the year, that is being on the large scale. And that's maintained a very steady increase. And most noise everywhere. And here is the total allocated plan that was projected back in 2021. And in fact, back then it was projected to be roughly $500 to $600 million plan. But we already have well exceeded. And with the continuing, the ubiquitous cloud computing and the AI needs, this is going to grow even further. So there's really no stopping of the need for continued scaling and increased transistor counts. So this has to continue, and the question really is how do we really do that? So let me again get back to the scale part of it with the FinFET. FinFET now has been more than 3 nodes that we have been using it. And the next discussion point really is what the industry would generally call it in effect for the sheets. There are several names to it, but the ribbon FET is the name that Intel uses. And what it achieves essentially is that just like in FinFET, where you had the gate,
then we will gain power on that it will allow you to really have much better error of practice simply because you have awesome failure rate control. This essentially helps you provide both your performance and the scaling. And if you look at the overall that drive per bottom area of the real estate that you have, that it does give you a clear superior benefit. And yet another benefit in gate power that we all know is the fact that you can have variable G or the width of the MAP sheets, and that helps you also provide a flexible design. And this is, and in terms of creating a very awesome flow for the gate power ancestors, quite simply it is really four big changes. And try to highlight that here. It really starts with the simple implementation of multi-layer stacks. And so that is the first big change. And the simple implementation is really the sacrificial layer that is subsequently released at a later stage. And then the other important aspect to GA transistors is really the formation of what's called the cavity or the inner spacer. And this is something that is really needed really to mitigate any fringing or the overall capacity. And so that is the second change. And the first change and the W volume removal would be less similar to what we do with the FinFET. And the next is really the nanowire or the nanowire release. So the sacrificial silicon remaining has to be released. So that way it will remain the silicon layers, and the silicon ripples will then be available for the next decade that we get. So in doing so, the process does evolve part from that release. Starting with really be able to successfully form the inner spacer and be able to get high quality circuits for straight films, and importantly really be able to achieve the multi-level function metal gates. And if you really look at the space between the ripples, which is commonly called the pieces, to be able to put the high gate and the per function metal, there is not a lot of space, and we cannot really have two larger pieces simply because the capacitance will go up. So we had to mitigate that, and that's where all the dipole engineering and the per-function metals, especially volumeless per-function metals, they really come off use. And this is also one of the active area, especially when we had to have 5 VDs for both P and VN devices. Now with the gate-all-around everybody, all major companies have adopted it, and there are different stages of implementation. Samsung already has a version of it in the production, and Intel is expected to have their first version for the 20A, which should be coming out this year, and the 18A should be following next year. And the next logical extension of the nanometers is really what was referred as the four sheets. First introduced by IMEC back in 2020 or perhaps a little earlier, and that's shown here in the bottom. This was one of the early versions of it, and since then IMEC has made really amazing progress in really improving the overall the integration scheme itself. In fact, some of you have attended yesterday Dr. Martin's talk in the keynote address on the improvements made. Essentially, it has basically a directed bomb, and because of which you can really be able to scale in the space. And with that, you can consequently increase the overall width of the sheets, and that really will help you overall red targets. So you can either make use of it in terms of really maximizing the red currents, or you can get better capacitance benefit. And the fact that you have less fringing from the source rate, you also get the capacitance benefit. So it's quite possible that this will really follow on as the next step towards the conventional gate power. So next I will go to the next inflection point, and that will be about getting the layer stack. And this can come in two flavors. And the one is called the sequential gate stacking. And this is where you essentially have the two transistors. In this case, top FinFET or the bottom FinFET. This was something that I made disclosed in 2018. And they are on the front and the back side of the wafers. And this is the sequential heterogeneous integration of the transistors. And in fact, this is not really all that new. Back in 2011, in fact, CEA had applicated. kinds of integration schemes possible, such as having GaN gallium nitride, for instance, then you can use it for the power and having the silicon transistors for the performance. That is one way to really do this. Yet the other way that we showed back in 2019 was really to integrate the germanium PMOS transistors. Germanium, as you know, has really much very good both mass port and but it also low radiant measure, so it cannot really have much higher temperature. And there are some unique integration aspects to really fabricate the germanium transistors. But with the sequential stacking, potentially it can really the two, that is the silicon NMOS and the PMOS, and be able to integrate it. And the early results in the workers actually look fairly reasonable. And of course, in all this, we do need fairly extensive unit of cell level and HTC analysis. The other way of really doing the layer stacking is now called the CFET or the stacked CMOS. And this is the HSP chronology publication back in 2020 from Intel, when they were able to show that the 3D stacked CMOS inverter, and in this case it was a 2 reverse stack, and showing actually fairly healthy transistor performance. And what it allows, of course, is because we are stacking the transistors, that it will allow you the cell height, and that certainly will help reduce the mass loss again. And the self-aligned, the patterning and the hair application, that of course is really one of the key challenges. And still there are many, many challenges in terms of really both the transistor and interconnect, the design aspects of it. And but that said, there's been a lot of progress made by many. TSMC showed results the last December medium, and also Intel also has been fabricating multiple variants of the CFET. Here's for example, I'm showing variant you have the NMOS on PMOS. So this is a 3 reverse stack here. So, and then of course there's an NDI layer in between. And just after the repetition, it's extremely important to look for how good the overall strength is. Especially when you are looking at the all stack or the multi layers here, it's important that the stack by itself is a little bit below the critical thickness and that they're not really having any dislocations. Except the fact is a very good way of really assessing that, and then you see that you can get good strength with more relaxation as you look at the asymmetric snaps. And here are the fully, this is after the selective deposition, and in this case, as I mentioned, the key was at the bottom, and this is the boron of the germanium phosphate, and the NMP of the phosphosilicon here is on the top. And the overall, if you look at the column gate of the devices, the performance is actually fairly reasonable, and in fact, it compares to the two reverse stack that I showed on the previous slide. And so this really is the right direction, and certainly a major inflection point in really scaling the transistors. And it also shows the effective overall high-density SRAM, and you can bring the machine SRAM density along the predicted lines. So the points in the red space here are for the nanosheets, and the four cubes expected to bridge the gap between the nanosheet and the CFET. We expect that if the green band is in the CFET, it should really get to the needed kind of density and maintain the scale. So that's much on the transistors, but I'll get back to the transistors in terms of the future innovations needed for addressing the power wall that I was mentioning earlier. Just on the interconnects, that we're also looking at the backside power delivery networks, and there are different variants of it, and the one that Intel is calling is the power via. What it essentially involves is really separating the signal from the power, and the power is really on the backside of the wafers. And what it allows you is really, because of this separation, that it allows a number of benefits. One is really to be able to Current notes, we things are getting more and more complex. And this is already happening here in different metal niches. Now, if you look at the future nodes and the metal pitch gets to 20 or lower, then you cannot really continue to rely on the copper. We, of course, we want to extend the copper as much as we can. And in fact, on the recent advances, the antimony barrier and more importantly, the selective barrier, and to be able to also not have the barrier at the bottom, that has to be helping. So we continue to be on that cloud. And also, because of the increase in the copper grain size, we expect to get the benefit. But at the end, we will be in this regime, where we once get here, that the damage to copper no longer can be supported, and the resistance will really show up. And this is where subtractive metals can become a big one here. And one such example that was published back in a few years ago, and it's also in Virginia. And it does scale very well. And in this particular case, very good scale even 18 nanometers. So this gets a really powerful as an opportunity to put subtractive metals when the metal pitch to be below 19 nanometers. That might be the possible point when this will become important. So next, looking at the packaging. 3D packaging is one, of course, is the one that is really going to propel the next level. And it comes in different forms. There is monolithic, which is die on package. And then there is what we generally call the 2.5D packaging. And this can be the multi-chip package, or the EMIB, embedded multi-die IC bridge, or it can be the polarized direct with the silicon interposer, or there is this ODI or the omnidirectional interconnects. This can also be categorized in two different ways. One has the face-to-face where the two dies are here facing one another, and the other is face-to-face, and this is the one where EMIB, for instance, would be a wall. And here is an example of a polarized direct. It is the base die and the top die. And with this kind of hybrid bonding approach, what is helping us also is the fact that the capacitances that can be greatly reduced. There is the disorder bonding, and you can see that the capacitance is significantly reduced when you go to HDI. Likewise, also in the resistance density, they also get a fairly large benefit. So that is yet another benefit in addition to the scaling advantage that you realize in these 3D packaging, and which is the reason that there is larger and larger number of applications really using it. So if it reduces the area, which means higher biodensity for the protein integration, and for the memory applications, it provides you better bandwidth, and therefore which is really needed for the memory and compute integration, and the lower capacities, as I just mentioned, both the resistance and the can have. And of course, the overall thermal resistance also is significantly reduced because of the proximity that is much lower. So here are some examples of how the industry is pursuing this advanced 3D packaging. And this is for example that case during the 3D face-to-face chip stacking for the heterogeneous integration. And so this is the computer right here with an active interposer. And then here's the memory modem. And these are integrated with the packaging. Initially, first the micro bumps to get the interposer. And from there to the package to the TSDs, so the two-stage MPS and the power bumps. And this is something that now is now currently being used in multiple products. And then there are different versions of it here. As you can see here, this fact scene offices going way back in 2019. And more recent ones will be followed by some of the cases. not really be giving up in density that there is the number of transistors and the frequency. And recall that the total power is scaling both dynamic and static power, and that is the series square F, and the F often increasing, and the number of devices increasing, this is really not helping us. So the 100 watts per centimeter square is approximately the wall that we have to really meet or stay less than 300. And because of this, the increase in the density and the frequency, that we still have this large issue of dealing with the power density. And so this constraint, what it does means is that we really have to come up with mitigation ways to really address the overall energy dissipation. So giving some examples in here, one is the macro emissions, and here is the overall water cooling, and there are some couple of studies here that we can overall reduce the overall heat dissipation. So that is being published already, and this is all that you can help, and you can reduce the overall average temperature of the system. And we really move it to much lower temperature, there are some significant benefits to be had. I'll show that on the next slide here. And this is an example of how the cooling can benefit in the overall mass and performance. So here's an example where going to room temperature to 37K, you can realize very large benefits in the channel mobility, both on the PMOS and the MOS devices, to the tune of 48 or 58% improvement. And if you look at the IEEE curves, again, you get much better heat threshold streams, and you also get better improvement in the overall resistance in the metal lines, and you also can improve the overall reliability. So this is certainly can will absolutely help, but of course the heat concentration will then be the cost and the efficiency. So that's something that we really have to pay for it, how we can really integrate this. And here's an example of how that at a normalized frequency, we can get much lower power, or in place of power, that you can get close to 50% of improvement in the overall frequency. So this is the power that I've been talking about, which is really getting 200 watts per centimeter squared, and this is what is called the millimeters. So to really mitigate this, we really have to come up with dimensions in achieving electrostatics, better channel mobility with alternate materials, and difficulty places, much steeper subthreshold strings, and so on. And this is a list of ideas that we work on. And again, thanks to the industry and more importantly, the academia, that we're getting not opposite here. The ones in blue here are the ones we think that will come before these, and the ones in the green here are much further. So let me give some examples in here. This is here from the work study from personal thing, and that this is the capacitance CV curve here to show that we have a tri-layer with not just the oxide but having the zirconium happening oxide and also combining that with anti-electrolytic superlattice, then you can actually get much higher. Yet another area where we can come up with material innovations and help is really an example in here where that with the laser growth gallium doping that you can get a PMOS mod at a specific much lower value. Currently the industry is looking at 21.22 μm², but we really need to be in this regime sub only minus 10 to be able to really achieve the needed contact resistivity for the scale not by dimensions. The other way of getting other material innovations needed, really as I mentioned about really improving the channel mobility, we did have some examples. So this is one that we published in the compressively string simulated in a channel driven. And what I'm showing here is the fall mobility at as a function of the whole density, and that the compressively string simulated in medium that we're able to achieve significantly higher channel mobility. And will translate into higher performance, and which you can then trade with the power. And this is an example wherein in the silicon-germanium strength and axis buffer, that you form the compressive silicon-germanium. Here the And this was really applicable in a sequential heterogeneous space, and that we showed that we can get very good performance both on the silicon as well as the in this particular instance, germanium. So string silicon germanium or germanium, that would be the way to really achieve or mitigate this power law. And of course, this CMOS integration is going to be quite complex. And the other way to really address this is really the forming the ribbons with either germanium or with the ideal approach of really having silicon germanium. In this case, they had a cracked layer of silicon germanium on top of silicon, and with this, you get two kinds of benefits. One, of course, successfully doing this, you get a mobility benefit, but also you get a UTI benefit. Another study here involves around the in gas. Medium thermostat is a great material for the electron mobility. It has very good properties when it comes to the scalability 0.5 ECC, and this is one, of course, also can really play into providing the group channel mobility and also the overall ECC scaling. And of course, these devices are not really as useful at higher ECC because of the given effects, but as the industry is already looking at the world over ECC, that materials such as germanium and gas will become very, very attractive. So moving further, of course, to the materials, the derivative of this conference is here. And the key benefit, of course, as we all know, is that we get better retrospect. So this is something that there have been quite a few publications that came forward from Intel, published a couple of years ago. And still there are many unresolved challenges, namely the contact resistivity, although the MIT group has made some improvements, and still we have ways to go here. The overall isolation and delay of the passivation stability itself is something that has to be continually worked on. And the has to be ultimately be ready on the 200mm tooling. And of course, the market channel stacking is going to be even more challenging and complex. But on the outset, tooling materials, they offer the ultimate scale simply because of the thickness values and extremely good delivery cycles. Finally, the other class of areas can relate to achieving steam storage. And one such example is really using the tunnel effects, where the barrier, really utilizing the tunnel barrier, and this can give you cost units of the post streams. In fact, there are multiple studies that show in the next slide that how we can get to be of 16 millivolts per decade. And because it has mentioned about band pattern is really provided for that. So here are some examples in here where there are whole bunch of studies included in here, where you see that the overall subtle shore strings as measured by the millivolt per decade, it is then below 60, and so there are multiple ways of really achieving it. And this one example where that the MIT group published a paper on a gallium antimony on EMAS junctions, and here they get excellent subthreshold signals. So there are still, of course, many, many challenges. These are really much further out at the overall effectivity and actually able to really get high quality DITs for the oxide and the integration, of course, as the other materials radius is still complex. And yet another thing you have to really combat the power law is really the use of the negative capacitance in CFETs. And an example in here to really show that how with the effects that we can achieve somewhat similar benefits, where the subtle shore strings, the lower subtle shore slopes, and much earlier characteristics. Again, we have multiple challenges in here. With the quality of the nature of the domain sizes and variation. and the four members, which is the 3D packaging, test case, as well as the team, test chair, all integrated in the same package. And this is what is really powering the hormone analysis computer, and this is where it really combines the 3D packaging innovations that really going into making this happen. And we'll see more of this. And an example up here to really show that on the base drive, that you can combine whole bunch of different kinds of types. Yet another way is that surface is not going to be nanoparty. Therefore, we have to really make some significant improvements here. I'm showing that electrical versus optical trade-off. If you use electrical routes, that you have to really use the repeaters and the network switches, and this really is not really as energy efficient. But then if you go to optical waveguides, you can make much superior energy efficiencies, and also the latency can be significantly lower. The combination of this and also going to the glass panels, that you can actually get much larger area. So what it really means is that at the wafer panel scales, you can get at system level for the data center needs, you can get a very large improvement in this scale. So what it all means is that this is where we go here, and you need to get the transistors, and we believe that the kinds of improvements that I mentioned at the wafer level and the optical interconnect that we can achieve through the kind of things that we have. So here's the conclusion that the most power is going to continue to drive our industry, and the power dynamic will be addressed in the new innovations. And I think the call to action really is I'm seeing a lot of crowd here in the college, the other crowd here that we our partnership with the academy is going to be much stronger moving forward, especially as we continue to perform more innovations, especially so as this is going to scale with more than a million transistors per package. Thank you so much.
You talk about all the new concepts that have been mostly discarded by the academic and industry for future devices, like thermostats, 3.5s, and you still think there's chance that they will come back, but I don't see them go past these days.
That's a very good question. I think with respect to germanium, the 3.5 complex semiconductors, there's a lot of interest before, but we also find that because it really doesn't scale with the VCC, unless you really go to below 0.5 points of voltage, it's not going to be as terribly useful, simply because the linkage has to be very large. My belief is that it will come off need. I think it's not a time. Likewise, some of the other ones that you mentioned about the injection effects and so on, I think that's still very, very integration issue that we need to resolve, and which is where we into the industry consortia and the academy are really address some of those key questions. I don't believe that's still ready yet. I think the logical sequence would still be through the 4G perhaps, CFET, and then really that would be the time I think of the question you want to be the next logical step.
Okay, thank you.
Other question? I have a quick one. Right now, so obviously, the same is trying to introduce more specific 3D structure. The other one is also the feature size is continuing to shrink. So eventually, maybe a quantum effect will become play a role, and for example, quantum tunneling. I'm wondering, as we continue seeing whether that's a problem for device reliability, not reliability in lifetime, but reliability in functionality, because you won't be able to control the electron very tightly into the quantum tunneling issue.
Very true. In fact, we already see that when we reduce, even in the case of nanometers, for instance, if you go below 3 nanometers, we already see the quantum tunneling effect, which results in the increase in the routine. And so that problem will become one of the most serious. I think the bigger issue really would be in the radiation. I think that maybe is the one that until we have a fundamental solution to that, that could really be at least key to the people. It's really important to get to hydrogen on data. It's a really interesting model that really looking at the quantum devices.
distinguish a speech. And the title of the talk will be Simulation and Analytics in the Astronaut Era. The talk will be given by Srini Prabhanaya from Synopsys. Srini is a Vice President of Engineering at Synopsys and lead the TCAD Mass Resolution and Smart Manufacturing Group at Synopsys, providing software solutions that help optimize the manufacturing process. These solutions are widely used by marketing mass shops, memory, logic, and foundry customers around the world. Srini has been involved with the IC design and EDA industry for over 30 years. His experience and expertise cover logic synthesis, physical design, low power synthesis, OPC, topography, TCAD, and smart manufacturing technologies. Srini is a graduate Stanford Executive Program at Stanford University and have a BSc and a master's degree in computer science. Now, please welcome Srini.
Good morning, folks. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'd like to talk to you. I'm high as a girl in Bangalore. So, we'll be coming back to Bangalore. Participate in a meeting of this quality is just an amazing thing. Of course, the bank has always been software, has always been a lot of focus on chip design and much revised and manufacturing. In one fell swoop, my own investment was a fixed match. So, thank you for this opportunity. We're happy to be here. So, let me go through and tell you a little bit about why I think that in this new era, we call that on the simulation and how this can be improved in the oil impact now. Here we can view it. And works, by the way, it's just as well. Yeah, it's great here. Right? I think we have professors of the PCAD working on it. So it's amazing how much you guys put it in this room already. So this is not news to you that simulation is really important. What is interesting is how they become more acute and the need for more acute. And also touch briefly on analytics as we look at files. The files become larger, the files become more complex, and how we will set it up so that we can actually optimize file operations and make it so that we get the best results for the various types of files.
Okay. So, with that, let me get started.
I think there are several results in this conference about developing the as to start with the most long slide, right? It's almost a concept of a lot of things. I want something to do, now that we're in the match time here, we don't show the most long slide anymore. We show a size of this time. Everybody looks up for that. The exact degree part of the show, right? And there's some for that. So I thought, a lot of my, way, my slides will be back, and then I'll make slides. So, okay, here's ChatGPT, let me use ChatGPT, and then make slides. And then I do it.
So I asked ChatGPT
to make me a slide about, Einstein's versus, nanoscale, how it has changed.
So here's what I got.
This is a problem. It's a great slide. It shows the transition from nanometers to Einstein. It's not a problem. It's a problem. But this is what came up. Just told me how much of Einstein. So, all the exciting for LLM start understanding. This is working problems. And we should get ahead of ourselves and we should see the problem slides. And what is this? But if you get there,
there's
a challenge.
that many of your students looking for the next project to take. If the addition of just one or two atoms to the gate stack will change your work function, how are you going to use them all? Clearly, you're not able to manufacture the good person. They have maybe four atoms to check out. Okay. So obviously you need information. And you know, here's an example of the challenge that we solve. How do we model this? How do we analyze this? How do we get this to the hands of our BDCO leaders so that they can build more efficient microphones? So that's the first challenge. Second challenge is on third factor. Right? This is also even more of a problem. People call that EUV. We get EUV will make it easier, you know, we can relax and so forth. But you know, what I'm showing here is it's tough. It's really hard. And we have, for example, analyzed stress and the EUV resistance. This is what we're doing first floor here. And then we have to analyze the impact of an underlayer. An underlayer is wrong because it's never going to be uniform. Right? Because the layers grow in different topologies. So there's going to be an unevenness to the underlayer. So now we are calling upon a simulator and give them simulator. Because you can't actually manufacture this and keep taking tests and steps. It's just very expensive. So this is the, and these are all very popular. The one other challenge for simulation. Let me give you one more challenge and then we'll take it. Here, what we have seen, and I think I heard yesterday in the talk of science, sort of this to this, is that we're now at a point where fabs and it penalizes the data. And these data are dispatched. The data frame. In fact, we come in a chamber. So they're all dispersed. What you're seeing is that you're collecting over half a million records in the fact. It's a good design situation. Good because we're able to collect it. There's a lot of stackers. Bad news is for the most part we don't see more good. This is scary for well. And also there's a lot of orthodox in the fact that does not really embrace the things. When they say, you know what you're doing, you're following what you're doing. But clearly a lot of ways to make this work. So I offer you these three challenges. Again,
experiments, you know, either via or in the lab, it's not practical. So,
here's the way we want to use quantum systems.
And you know, one chance that this world takes millions of atoms, too much to have those atoms. Atoms and quantum are very important. If you are using them,
please
check them out. There is a lot of good progress that has happened over the last few years that you can truly listen about. But these are very computational tests. You cannot take a full transistor and say, tell me what you do. So what we want to do instead is focus on the process of transistor. And one of the things that you all know about is doing here, especially big old stack. This is a problem that is a much better is not applicable to experiments in fact cluster. Because the low flow, the unity of the world is a lot of two atoms to get the 100 atoms to be set, but makes an exchange to your difference to your unity of the world. So I don't want to go through all this in detail, but you can see what we are trying to show, that successively we do zoom in on areas that are most interesting to you, and then use quantum simulation to reason about what's going on in the game, reason about the leaky, reason about how we can play with the game that we want. Okay. So the takeaway, the first takeaway is on the start of the game.
Yes.
Our path in the darkness is very good. The most takeaway is that quantum simulation is very powerful. It's a tool that we should use in research to help you move faster than what you can do. It's not meant for a whole bunch of strength or small area. For that area, the root analysis, we can help you.
That's the first thing we want.
So now I'm going back to the slide that I started with, right? And what you see is, as best I can tell, we put a single hologram atom. Single atom. Right? A single atom change, and they will be differently than whatever goes on. And you are able to reason about it. So here you're going to see the whole table stack cake here in Austin. And I can write it in the room. Another one is the thing that we put in the last time to see how Mondo style produces the first time. And you can see the core function change from 1-4 functions to the change. Right? So it's not copy the struggle. And if you can get a tool that allows you to use, you should embrace it, right? And you can pull it. And in the end, of course, not investing in files, so forth, but never being a capacity of my specialization. Simulation is the great one. So here's some eye candy from my competitor, the cool stuff that you can get through simulation. You can actually structurally build up your transistor set, zoom in, be able to take the measurements, and be able to twist. Then move on to do easier. So allow me a moment to get us across what we need to do. This is a field illustrated area, a very important area, especially if you're trying to develop field gates, the 200-meter, the 40-day, the 200-day technologies. Creating a field gate very clear. You see, all this is very different. Not good idea, try to use differently in the form. So, my plea to you is we are not on where each CO began to fight the level high of the level. In the sense that we can get directional answer. And that will allow you to make good choices on your device structure, pitch, and allows us to learn for you to create. Spice, people say, you have a problem, some logs file, take the permissions, then compare the spice. Well, that's a schematic problem, you don't have all the permissions. Now, what we're seeing some of our solutions is that they can go from VCAD solution, VCAD model, to what might be a spice. Get your PDA 0.1, you can directly interact, you have a few days, right? Then you can build the smart cell library lab, you can then try out the basic algorithm to that, and decide if you would like this. Because, again, the synopsis we've seen many, many generations of technologies come and go. What we want is that if you want to know how your smart cell library will work with your baseball tool, there is no option other than just trying it out. You cannot extrapolate the previous model without a major change. So if you don't do a PCO this solution, you might have to understand why you sell off of the process. So the CPCO might have descended to the simulation and simulate open, right? Simulate well enough that you actually live it with a PDA to create access to library. Use access to library to use the place in our algorithms that tell you whether your time is set up to the library or not. So it's a low cost, quick way of doing it, something that we should all succeed. But this is a big story. But if you have all of the different things, you require the GA, backpack or something, recycling, things like this before. This is not the web itself to actually submit back to the solution. And you also have that's why ESC also says that more and more of the improvements in our in a moment, I talk about vacuum, and we'll see why Christian is saturating why these other approaches, why you need to keep your process moving forward. Now, somebody who is not asked, he can explain this to the university. Is it practical for us to do all the things you want to do? And so, who do parts of the contest? I accept that there is a different visualization. But if you choose like sections of the device to analyze, then you can perform. But also, we are working on ML-based approach to find ways to these as a quite on, you know about it, these are physics-based, ML, physics-based ML solutions. And if you use this judiciously, you can keep accuracy essentially to where you used to be and get significant TAD. statement asked too much. It asked how much for what I see easily get 5x to put inside by using some kind of physics. So what I want to tell you is that we will continue to improve the test cycle so that we can continue to use simulation as a first line defense and when it comes to design processes. Okay. I'll just finish up the test section by pointing out one more thing that Jeff Hoover published this fact. In this analysis, using PCAD can save cost quite dramatically. Right? Because labor costs will be more and more challenging. We're talking about $3,000, $4,000 for labor. Now, a year back in the latest world, we were talking about tens of dollars for labor. So, we can find ways to minimize that. And as Mr. Jeff says here, he has a good invite you to apply. And there are many other challenges that have to be simulated. I don't have to go all that. Again, we get sex, stress and caring, prosthetics, we don't know those people, packing, cross the difference. Very good to. Heart collapse and leak, all kinds of sometimes challenges can be handled through simulation. So again, this was being related. My key message to the audience is simulation is our focus for you to get directional information on how to do it. It's very interesting.
More and more, they are in the
let me show you some posture. These are some of the things that I looked at when we went to the new home, when we went to, you know, 48, not the most of the to the 48. Look at the number of homes. You mean my practice was home, was home, homes. Located in the subsense of my question. You know, I mean, the power of this part, right? The sea of wisdom was inhabiting this to the cliff. We should not go to the wisdom. Not your sense. I know people advise that to me. Now, religion, but again, you can't be pretty familiar with this. You know, the longest time, all of which has learned that, they might, right? And they believe that is. So, now that third, because it used to be better than the rules. Imagine a mask with three third features, how we were reasonable. And so on, right? I can think already got to go but he like, here is that there are, you know, many, many new effects that we know that all have to be come to form through learning papers, to navigate the content that I discuss. You have to wait for a long time. You will be distinguished from that. The rules are all you do right now. You will be required to navigate. Let me show you one picture. Most of you here probably have seen this already on the science picture. So there it is, right? So here, this is a plant, this is a diagram. Of course, go there, you should look at my cursor here. It's a plant that is working on the plate. Imagine this part here. Your eyes. Did this have a big mass? It looks like this. Right. For those of you that are not familiar with the mass, masks are used in the manufacturing, like the negative is used in a product. Back to the negative, right? Right. Print forward. This is another negative. This is a mass to the negative. Now, only in this first year, this is a negative which is nothing like the photo. Because we are not in a machine where every second hour of four hour effect of light condition is ridiculous. So, you know, this was funny enough. Think about on this rectangle, I have made masterpieces like this. So, that's what I did. I also created these so called assist features on the mask. But they are smaller, they don't make the way. Imagine, if I print on the paper that I've got, it'll mess up your chip. But if I don't have it, this is features. Do not print. How do you get this process working? Simulation, right? You can simulate the diagrams. You can move this back and back and forth. You can type it in your finger. So, and then again, it's a vertical feature, it's a horizontal feature, everything changes. We made this work, it's a solution. We should print, we should erase the solution. Okay, well, that's one last slide that we get posted. This is the math. What do you think it prints? The image of this is that there's almost a correlation between what our math is and what's the way. But in this system, for this is substance, but if I want to bring substance on paper, I create to my next discussion topic, which is cloud analytics. Yesterday we had a good talk on this topic. We looked at numbers about how it's becoming more and more challenging. We talked about more than 500 different kinds of data. We collected metabolized system data. Sensor data is a biometric device. You can get pulse, right? You can see how it is going, how it is going, how it is going, how it is.
So, the simple point I'm making you is that without doubt, AI or analytics, the only way we can give this information.
Petabytes, half a billion worth of data, nobody uses.
But I got my customers to say, please don't give me one more analytical tool, because simple response on problems is very low. There's a lot of false errors in our neurons. A lot of false errors.
That's what I say. You know, you find changes behind every flat you raise. I can do nothing else in my life. There's so much of that.
This is a big body. Thank you. This is what I hear more and more. So, what we're working on, what we're doing recently, is a complete AI-based solution that will automatically detect anomalies and make recommendations. And both of them are important. You want to be able to look back in this state. When is the last time you have seen a problem? What do you do? Because you have different days, different people on call, different people are on the path. Or then you might know that yesterday somebody else saw the problem. Spend hours together trying to figure out. So what you want is you first want some alerts, you also want some recommendations, and you want to be able to have a recognition. This is what we are offering you to small businesses. The feedback is very positive. This is yet one more way of implementing the simulation. You don't need it. You're basically simulating fact. Saying a lot, it's true. We are actually simulating equipment, simulating process, simulating what should happen given these sensors, what should happen given this condition, and then presenting options.
Okay. What makes sense?
Again, point is this kind of stuff used to be done manually before, not possible. Have you some kind of automatic AI system. Now,
speaking of software, I think leading customers, I hear from them the need for what they call data farming. The idea is that you want to get data from the whole process of your customer. Being good design, being good development. He can want to do your EDA, to do your math, algorithms, do your personal analysis, do your product analysis. Product analysis, when I get that line, you look at all this stuff.
Your lab engineer
does not know whether that particular feature is talking, real or not. It's off or not, not a feature. And that is sorry, what? So the data connection we can get more information and draw that information across the domain, extract insights that can then be used to more efficiently modify. Okay, so this is a communication message that we did prepare by thousands of machines, tens of thousands of papers, hundreds of thousands of sensors collecting data.
Demo this
manually. For me, this nice little group here is just standing there, mapping AI global work. That's all of our goal. In fact, AI is pretty powerful. So this is not just a pipe thing. We have a working pipe. So here is an example of our test data that we analyze automatically in a short run only. We will do that. We have the works automatically. Line, segmentation, cleansing, grouping. All this needs to be done without any operator question. Operators cannot do this. Once you have all that done, you can use your AI to find anomaly. Once you find anomaly, give suggestions to follow them.
Okay, so the next one that is going to be
Thank you very much.
So there are many chips, that's a shop of
iron.
here. Let's thank Shreeni one time.
So next session will start at 11.